I had decided long before that DD had what it took to be a fine Prime Minister. Clever, principled, and self-made. Above all, he was a brilliant example of social mobility and could inspire people struggling and pinned down by the system. Coming from a difficult start in life, being brought up on a South London council estate by a single mother, he was now an example that anyone could make their way to the top in Britain. Children in Lascelles in Birmingham or Hackney in London could see that he was someone to whom they could relate. His example could inspire and motivate them. I'd seen from our time together in the Whip's office too, his resilience under pressure and his strategic judgment. His general toughness was underlined by his military activity in the Special Air Service territorials, meaning, as one wag put it, that he knew how to kill people in 20 different ways, but only at weekends. By the beginning of August, DD was knackered. It had been an extremely exhausting year, and he wanted to spend the month recovering with his family. I urged him to prepare his conference speech. I suggested that he set out what he could do as Prime Minister for our country, how it would change under his leadership, and how he would build on the Thatcher, and indeed the Blair, legacy. When we returned to London in September, he had not written his speech at all. He had succumbed to invitations from colleagues to visit their constituencies in what should have been a restful month. We were now within weeks of the conference, so I asked the brightest wordsmiths in the party, Paul Goodman, the first of the new intake to sign up to DD's team, Damien Green, Nick Herbert, David Willits, and Ian Dale, with some assistance from Robin Harris, Mrs. Thatcher's speechwriter, if they would meet and draft DD's offer to the party and the country so he would have a cortex to work on.